Hello, it is the 20th day of July, Year of Focus 2020. I'm making this video to UN employees that are governed by their own covenants. The UN didn't get to make covenants that the member nations agreed upon without first acknowledging those covenants certainly apply to UN officials and the things that they are doing. So that means a member of the public of a member signatory nation like Canada that demands accommodation of a WHO official, the World Health Organization being a member of the United Nations, they are a service provider. And when I, as a man of faith and beliefs, a minister of Christ, makes a demand for accommodation for my faith, that puts the service provider in an incontrovertible duty to accommodate and must go to hardship to accommodate the demand, unless it can be proven upon the balance of probabilities that it's frivolous or will bring harm to men or women or property. That being a given, because certainly there's no validation for anybody that wishes to wreak harm or damage to others by exercising faith. That is just illogical, makes no sense whatsoever. Whereas my faith and beliefs are based upon the King James Bible. And what I have noted in my endeavors to get public servants of these signatory nations to go to hardship to accommodate my faith is they know nothing about it. They are totally ignorant of their duty to go to hardship to accommodate a demand for faith-based issues. It could be for a disability. It could be for LGBTQ. And I've used that as an example, as they demanded loudly and proudly, and they got what they wanted. They've been sticking it to people from behind for a long time, and they got what they wanted. They are now in the Privy Council of Canada's office, as being by the grandfather document, the King James Bible, they are vastly discriminated against by the God that started this legal system worldwide, and they are told that they are despicable and will not be respected. It must be even put to death. So you can see how the LGBT community extremely discriminate against the Bible and those people who follow it. Now, keeping in mind, they came after the fact. The Bible's grandfathered, faith and beliefs are grandfathered. Article 18 of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights cannot be derogated from. I'm demanding accommodation under that article, and I'm saying I was here as a man created by the Creator before the LGBTQ crowd came into play to try and knock me down and saying that I don't get to believe in God and they're going to punish me if I try to exercise my faith in God. That's what's taking place because in the Privy Council of Canada, the LGBTQ office has now sprung up. We've made a demand for accommodation for religious beliefs of the Privy Council of Canada's office, which is the highest regulatory office in the country. Nobody supersedes the clerk of the Privy Council. He is the highest in rank next to the Queen. So when we find out that he's been arbitrarily influenced by LGBTQ and he will not go to hardship to meet our demand for accommodation, which was received by him by registered mail on 3 separate occasions and 7 different witnesses confirming. So we're having great difficulty getting the officials in Canada to recognize they have an absolute duty to go to hardship to accommodate a demand. Section 180 of the Criminal Code was tried to be repealed by the Canadian government for 2 years. They tried to repeal it. That's the one that holds them accountable if they make you feel uncomfortable by trying to prevent you doing anything that's common to all of Her Majesty's subjects, such as exercising, practicing the Christian faith. It was apparent that they, in league with trying to remove 176, the corrupted lawyers in bed with the satanic enterprise also tried to remove 176 of the Criminal Code, feeling vindicated after repealing 296 of the Criminal Code in 2016. That was the blasphemy law. We have an acted effort to destroy religious beliefs and the ability to practice them within the Parliament of Canada. And those service providers so signed on and signatory and obligated by the Emergencies Act in Canada, which ratifies the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the Covenant on Economical, Social, and Cultural Rights. They're both ratified as law in the Canadian Emergencies Act. Well, in a Christian monarchy that is styled in the Royal Style and Titles Act as Defender of the Faith, that's her title. A man or a woman that's sworn that they will be faithful and bear true allegiance to that woman who is styled as Defender of the Faith has zero position whatsoever to intimidate you, nuisance you, or obstruct you when you're demanding he accommodate the exercise of your faith. They engage in grievous criminal activities as supported by the WHO agenda. The WHO are the one that got them to sign these signatories, and I'm demanding of WHO officials that they do a video to let all officials in a position of government and as service providers around the world know that they have an absolute duty to go to hardship to accommodate a reasonable demand for faith and beliefs or physical disabilities or sexual orientation or whatever those discriminated protected areas are. And the reason that I'm demanding a video be done for that is it's obvious the disregard for those duties is apparent. It's extremely apparent when you demand accommodation for your faith, you get treated rudely. You get treated in an abusive manner. You get slandered. You get sworn at. You get hung up on. You get told to leave the building, all because you're demanding accommodation for your faith. Now, it is certainly within the mandate of WHO officials and the United Nations that is part of the WHO. The World Health Organization is a member of the United Nations, and as a service provider, they are duly bound and obligated, all of its officials, to go to hardship to meet a demand for accommodation. When one of the member states has a member that says, I'm demanding accommodation because the member state that you're supporting and going along with is doing nothing to respect religious beliefs. And we can see that with the United Nations Commissioner on Religious Freedoms, the rapporteur, with the issue in Quebec. He did nothing. He's acting more like a toothless watchdog or ombudsman than an official that has the ability to use the power of the United Nations to cite the member country for violation of the covenant. It would seem like it is a bit of a useless effort to have these covenants in place when there is no enforcing power for anybody that's being discriminated against to have the covenants obeyed. It would appear the practice is to disobey the government's signatory obligations first, disobey them and break the covenants first, and have you fight tooth and nail to get through a corrupted legal system that only seems to have respect for persons of law. That's a pretty terrible word if you happen to be a minister of Christ that can read Deuteronomy 1:17, Deuteronomy 10:17, 2 Samuel 14 and 14, Matthew 22:16, Acts 10:34, Romans 2:11, and finally James 2:9, advising all who read the Bible and have faith in Christ that if you have respect to persons, you commit sin and are convinced of the law as a transgressor. I'm writing and speaking to men and women. I certainly don't speak to corporate entities with names written with all capital letters and backwards formed like obituary columns or tombstones. I cannot speak to men and women that qualify themselves as persons and wish to only be seen and spoken to in their official capacity as a person, hiding behind corporate liability, limited liability. No, I can only speak to men and women as my Bible advises me that if I would dare respect or speak to or show any type of indication towards positive communication with a person, then I'm a sinner. That's pretty clear in the Bible. That's not twisting the words of the Bible. That's taking it verbatim from the King James 1611 Bible that rules this Commonwealth and that the UN has people under signatory to. The International Covenant, Article 18. That means that my faith and beliefs in that King James Bible is inviolable. It's unalienable. It's inherent. It can't be taken away And I'm demanding that you make a video to inform all of the public officials around the world that when it comes to the matters of faith and beliefs, that when a demand comes upon them, they immediately go to hardship, snap to attention, and say, yes, sir, what would you like? That is not taking place in the world today, largely because your video efforts have not decided that it needs to be done. Well, maybe it was because you were ignorant of the fact that there's a problem with these covenants being ignored by those service providers and public officials that are obligated and bound by them. There is no process within a corrupted court where the judges themselves are some of the violators of these human rights. You cannot get justice in a court where a judge will not respect his duty to go to hardship to accommodate your beliefs of not being a person. It's a real problem when you're trying to waive all assumptions that you're wishing to be recognized as a person, and the judge starts intimidating you, disrespecting you. That happened to me 7 times. I had 5 witnesses complain, and those 7 judges were disqualified. They can never sit before me again, but they're still sitting on the bench, and the rest of the judges are still huffing and puffing and intimidating people to violate their faith, having no respect whatsoever for their ability to exercise it, and the duty upon them to go to hardship to ensure that a demand for accommodation of faith is respected. So that's an extreme problem in a world to put up the hoodah, oh, look, we got human rights, we'll respect you and do good by you when it comes down to the end of the day. It was just a piecemeal exercise and makes you feel intimidated. A wasted bit of your life has gone by knowing that those particular human rights that they put in place were just put there to make you feel good and to make the profits of the insurance underwriters and the risk management agents that brought these human rights legislation into place. Well, they're going to make a lot more money. Because as long as some of those human rights are respected, there's going to be less claims against the insurance underwriters and they will profit more. This obviously, when one follows the money, becomes the maxim as to why things are the way they are with the human rights legislation and why the officials are not respecting it. Human rights and insurance underwriters have one thing in common: money. They're thinking about profit, and these human rights legislations were put there not to benefit men and women, but to benefit the insurance underwriters to make it so there would be less claims, less payouts. Now, this is common sense, and nobody can dispute it, although it may be the first time you've heard it. You're formulating this in your mind right now, and you're realizing, oh my God, that's true. Human rights were put together to protect the insurance underwriters that were engaged in insuring all these public service liability corporations. They didn't like the large amount of claims that were coming their way and they were having to pay out. So they put together the human rights legislation and covenants and got all the insured corporate countries to sign on, or they would not receive preferred and beneficial insurance rates. They would have to pay exorbitantly high rates to insure their public officials because they didn't agree to the human rights risk management campaign, so the insurance underwriters would have a higher rate of profit. So again, I'm demanding accommodation for my faith that somebody with power within your organization recognizes that, oh my God, he's right. I do have a duty to go to hardship to accommodate him, and I certainly can't classify doing a video to all the service providers around the world that have become signatories to these covenants to inform them they have an absolute, undeniable duty to go to hardship to accommodate the inherent freedoms that are demanded of them by the recipients of these people that are calling upon them and relying upon them as service providers. I'm a man, and I am respective of my ability to exercise my faith in Christ, and I'm demanding the same take place by a video reflective of those duties and obligations be put forth to those signatory service providers that are desperately in violation of the covenants that they entered into. This isn't an assumption. It isn't some sideline thing that doesn't really matter much, because when you intimidate, obstruct, and nuisance people to violate their faith and put them in jail because they were trying to violate, exercise their faith, that's an extreme violation of these covenants worldwide, and nobody's paying attention to it. You all seem to wish to stick your head in the sand and point the finger saying some other man or woman has the duty to do this, not I. Well, when you find the public service providers in the signatory positions that you've brought them into with these international covenants and the dictates of the World Health Organization, such as wear masks, when you bring people into discomfort because you're making them do something that's a violation of their faith, now the liability is upon you. And I'd like some integral, honorable man and woman to agree with that and say, yes, it makes perfect sense that the service providers who are signatories to these covenants must be educated and upgraded as to their undeniable duty and absolute demand upon them to go to hardship to accommodate a demand for religious beliefs. This is immutable. It is inherent in every man and woman to exercise their faith and beliefs. But your system has allowed all of these service providers to turn a blind eye, be arrogant, and instead intimidate, obstruct, nuisance, and be very difficult with men and women, where they intend to slander them and defame them, such as myself. I've been slandered and defamed by public servants that recognize I represent an extreme threat to the bar system, the justice system of the world, because any man with a Bible exercising faith and demanding accommodation can remove that judge from his illustrious commercial position and bring him down to nothing other than a service provider that must go to hardship and tell all the other public officials they must obey my ability to practice my faith and beliefs without obstruction to a T. That means they must back off with their assumption that I'm a person and all their statute, code, and regulation applies to me. If they have proof that a damaged party or woman or property exists, then I'm liable. I'm guilty. If they don't have any proof and it's some victimless crime written down in statute, code, and regulations, it's not applicable to me. It's only applicable, as stated in their own interpretation act, persons. It is only applicable to persons. Now, that's not a disputable fact, but it is an immeasurable fact of power when one recognizes their faith in that scripture, directing them to not respect persons. You cannot be intimidated to participate in a fraud run by men and women that wish you to violate your faith by respecting their personage. So I'd like somebody there with integrity and honor to get back to me at 780-399-6250. Or send me an email at owlmon@gmail.com. Or you can write to me at 12431 90th Street, Edmonton, Alberta. No postal code. I'm non-commercial, as the letter mail regulations of Canada and the Minister of Canada Post said, I'm right. I don't have to use a postal code if I'm not engaged in commercial activity. Well, since doing that violates my faith in Christ, I certainly can't do that. Therefore, it cannot be demanded of me that I use a postal code. I was one of those men that heard the inference that ignorance of the law is no excuse. I was brought up with the Bible, and I went and examined man's law to find out who he had authority over. And that's when I found out it only has authority over persons. And that's when I found out the Bible and God absolutely condemns respecting persons. So that position in front of you now puts you in the incontrovertible position of having to go to hardship to accommodate my faith based on that King James Bible. I'd like you to get back to me with more of your questions as to exactly what you think I want about making a video that would be stringent upon the fact that these public officials, subject to Article 18 of the ICCPR, have no position whatsoever to argue, obstruct, nuisance, or intimidate men and women wishing and demanding that their faith be respected and they get to exercise it unimpeded. So I look forward to hearing from you and somebody that acts with honor that will look up above them and saying, why am I feeling afraid if I try to say something or help this man? Somebody up above me will fire me. Well, that's because you have corruption working up above you. It's quite common in this world that absolute corruption absolutely corrupts. Power corrupts. An absolute power absolutely corrupts. Well, the WHO has been running wild recently, like they have absolute power, until President Trump canceled their funding. So I'd like somebody there. I am demanding that they accommodate me by getting back to me at any of those three listed communication modalities. I look forward to hearing from you. May God bless. Bye for now.